This is All India Radio. In the program Spotlight now, we bring you a discussion on BRICS Foreign Ministers Meeting. The participants are Ashok Sajjanhar, former diplomat, and Simran Sodhi, journalist.
Today we are discussing the BRICS Foreign Ministers Meet that was held yesterday. The foreign ministers of the BRICS nations, that is Brazil, Russia, India, China, South Africa, all attended the meeting and various important agreements and decisions were made. Ambassador Sajjanhar, the first thing that one notices about the BRICS foreign ministers meeting is the fact that all the nations focused on the response to the COVID-19 crisis and also in ensuring equitable access to vaccines during this process. How do you see this development and the BRICS cooperation during this COVID time?
Well, over the last 1 year or so that we have had the COVID-19 pandemic with us, I think all international meetings, you know, whether they are intergovernmental or they are multilateral, I think the issue of dealing with the pandemic has taken the top billing as far as the discussions are concerned. And over the last 5 or 6 months, ever since we got the vaccines also, I think the issue of affordability and accessibility of vaccines has also come in for discussions wherever meetings have taken place. So I don't think it comes as a surprise that even here, that when the ministers are meeting, whether it is in their opening statements or in the media statement that has been issued or even the statement on reform and strengthening of the multilateral system, in all these places, this occupies a very important and a very significant place. And it is also satisfying that the proposal that has been put forward by India and South Africa, that is for a temporary waiver on patents for COVID-19 vaccines, diagnostics, therapeutics, medicines, masks, etc., that has found acceptance and support by all the ministers. Of course, there is still a long way to go because we have seen the history of this proposal. It was put forward in October last year, but then after that, it did not make much progress. It got some life when the US President Joe Biden lent his support to the proposal. But still, we have seen that even at the G20 meeting some weeks ago, the European Union is still not fully convinced. After all, it's now a grouping of 27 countries, and so all of them have to be on board. But it is a matter of satisfaction that at least these five developing emerging market countries, they have put their full weight behind this proposal. So once it comes, it is discussed in detail at the WTO, I think we should be able to see some rapid forward movement.
Ambassador Sajjanhar, we've also seen that this meeting took place against the backdrop of the India-China border standoff. And we've also seen China's aggressive and very dominating behavior in the neighborhood and also to some extent globally. We find that the BRICS nation grouping also reaffirmed the importance of territorial integrity and sovereignty of states and the need to resolve problems through peaceful means. How do you see this as an indirect messaging going out to China, and how significant is this statement by the BRICS nations?
Well, yes, you are right. For the last more than a year, we have now seen that there has been hostilities between India and China. It was, in fact, on the 5th of May last year that the first altercation between the two countries took place on the banks of Pangong Lake, as also in Sikkim. And it was on the 15th of June that we had the skirmishes in the Galwan Valley. So this has been a time of tension and stress as far as the two countries are concerned. But this was not reflected in any of the statements that were made. If I speak about the statement by the Chinese foreign minister, he did not refer to any of the contentious issues. He only spoke about the manner in which India is dealing with the second wave of coronavirus. And he said that China and all members of the BRICS are ready to support India in every way. As far as External Affairs Minister Dr. Jaishankar is concerned, his statement, as you referred to just now, was very telling because he advocated for a fair, just, inclusive, equitable and representative multipolar international system, he said, which is based on international law and the UN Charter that recognizes the sovereign equality of all states and respects their territorial integrity. This was a message to the Chinese foreign minister, although not overtly, but implicitly. And he also mentioned that the disputes and problems between the countries should be resolved on the basis of dialogue and while upholding international law and principles enshrined in the Charter of the United Nations. So this was significant in terms of the exchange, and the messaging would definitely have gone to China, but this did not in any way adversely impact upon the very important and substantive declarations and statements that were brought out after the meeting of the ministers.
Ambassador Sajjanha, we also see that this is the first time that the BRICS foreign ministers agreed on a standalone joint statement on strengthening and reforming the multilateral system. They agreed that such reforms have to cover all key multilateral institutions, which include the UN and its organs such as the UN Security Council, the UN General Assembly, global financial institutions such as the International Monetary Fund, the World Bank, even trading systems, including WTO and the global health system, which has WHO at its very core. How significant, Ambassador Sajjanha, do you feel is the fact that one feels an urgency, and this is reflected in this joint statement of the BRICS nations, that the multilateral system that kind of puts checks and balances globally is outdated and is in desperate need of a reform? And realistically speaking, how much of a difference or a push does this provide for these multilateral reforms then?
Well, it is significant that the BRICS foreign ministers decided to issue a separate joint statement on strengthening and reform of the multilateral system, because we have seen over the last many, many years that the multilateral system is not operating to its potential. In fact, of course, the United Nations has many successes to its credit. But the situation that we see today, the multilateral system, its authority has been eroded. Its credibility has been very significantly diluted. And in fact, that has been visible very much during the time of the pandemic. Because you would recall that when the pandemic started at the beginning of last year, the multilateral system was nowhere to be seen. In fact, the UN Security Council could not even meet during the month of March, when this pandemic was raging at its worst, because it was mentioned at that time by the then chair of the UN Security Council, China, that this was not a security, peace and security issue, but it's a health issue. So when the multilateral system really was required to be in position and to act, it was found missing. The next month when the UN Security Council met, still they could not come to any sort of agreement because of the differences and the altercations between the two main proponents, that is the United States and China. So multilateral system has not been effective, and Prime Minister Modi in his comments last year on the 75th anniversary of the United Nations had said that the United Nations, the multilateral system, has been found wanting because it does not reflect the realities of today. It is still working on the basis of instruments that were devised and designed 75 years ago, when the situation was very different. At that time, when the United Nations started, we had only 53 members. Today, there are more than 190 members of the United Nations. And still, the structure of the UN Security Council has not changed. So, obviously, it is not designed to deal with effectively with the challenges that the world faces today. So Prime Minister Modi has been speaking about it. Other world leaders have been speaking about a reformed and a strengthened multilateral system. And I think this joint declaration, joint statement that has been issued by the ministers is a recognition of this fact. And it speaks about, as you said very rightly, that the United Nations Security Council, General Assembly, the Economic and Social Council, as well as the financial organs and instruments like IMF, World Bank, other agencies, WTO, WHO, it speaks about the reform of all these organs and agencies. Now, to respond to your question whether this will be effective, I think this will have some contribution to make to push towards reform of the multilateral trading system, multilateral system per se. But I don't think it's going to have a very significant impact, because if you look at the expansion of the UN Security Council, it is basically China which has been standing in the way of its expansion. Starting from 2015 and then again in 2017, we have a text on the basis of which negotiations could be conducted for an expansion of the UN Security Council, both in the permanent as well as in the non-permanent category. But it is always China that is putting obstacles, that is putting spokes on the way, creating obstructions, and we have not really been able to make much progress. And looking at China's behavior in the manner in which it has been acting, particularly over the last 1.5 years, ever since the virus first emerged from Wuhan in China, it does not appear to be very likely that China will change its views and start supporting negotiations on text to reform the system and to expand the UN Security Council.
Ambassador Sajjanhar, we also see that in the joint statement, there is a reference to cross-border movement of terrorists, terror financing networks, and safe havens. The BRICS members also refer to the counter-terrorism strategy adopted at the grouping summit last year and reiterated their commitment to finalize a result-oriented action plan by the counter-terrorism working group in 2021. Would one be correct in assuming that this hint or this reference then is to Pakistan? And this is a point that India has been making at various international forums, repeatedly urging the global community to realize the seriousness and the urgency of this issue.
You are right. This reference can definitely be taken to mean that it points towards Pakistan. But again, what we have seen as far as the behavior of China is concerned, that on this forum, it will say all that is required, because all this language is definitely a language that is used by India when we are talking about dealing with terrorism, countering terrorism, and particularly from Pakistan, which provides safe havens and provides state support and provides funding and training of the terrorists. So China agrees to all this very much, but immediately after this, it will go and address some other meeting or in a bilateral context, and it will also refer to the huge contributions that Pakistan has made towards dealing with the terrorism, towards battling terrorism, and what are the losses that it has suffered on its own. You would recall that in the BRICS summit that took place in 2017 in Xiamen in September, there we had mentioned about 10 terrorist groups, and they included groups like Lashkar-e-Taiba, Jaish-e-Mohammed, Haqqani group, Taliban, etc. All of these were mentioned, but just a few days after that, the Chinese foreign minister received his counterpart from Pakistan and was lauding the contribution of Pakistan in terms of fighting terrorism. So there is a lot of hypocrisy in what China says and what China does. There is a huge mismatch between the two of them. But still, I think this is useful. These statements are useful because when we are at other fora, for instance, if it is discussions in the Financial Action Task Force, if it is discussions with the United States, with the European Union, then definitely these are statements that can be brought to their attention to say that there is commonality of views and commonality of purpose in dealing with the terrorism that emanates from Pakistan in our region.
And in the coming days, we will continue our discussions on the BRICS grouping as well as on Afghanistan and the other pertaining issues. With this, we bring today's discussion to an end. Thank you.
Thank you.
You were listening to a discussion on BRICS Foreign Ministers Meeting. The participants were Ashok Sajjanhar, former diplomat, and Simran Sodhi, journalist. This program was produced and presented by the News Services Division of All India Radio. You can listen to it on our mobile app, News on AIR. This program is also available on our website, newsonair.com. You may email your opinion about this program at airnsdtalks@gmail.com.